John Sinclair gave a paper on creating dictionaries. This is the creating the object. And, you know, obviously that comes through. What I wanted to do, though, was to talk about the field. I won't make a discipline because there are, I want to talk about something much larger. So it's lexicography and, of course, the people who do it. Why? Why not? There's a lot to be praised, and we don't praise it enough. It is a noble nature craft. We go back a very long time in history. So this should be made known. It's a scholarly pursuit for many, and we have very many brilliant people who have followed this to find the meanings of words and how you capture them in an elegant way in a book we call a dictionary. It has become an academic discipline, this is more recent, and above all, it's an extremely dynamic field. And it is because we don't, I believe, we don't sell academic endeavor enough, and funding for university work, research work, is drying up. As purely by accident, the same time as I became president of Eurolext, I became a vice president of the university, and I found myself working in policy work, and that's when I realized how important it was not to just exist, but to show you exist if you really want to stay. So some of this is about policy work rather than pure dictionary. Now, the next thing I wanted to do, because we're praising lexicographers, is this is a line from one of my favorite poems by Louis MacNeice, a fanfare for the makers. The people who do things, and people who've done things for me, because I was a language teacher. I was teaching paid hourly in a French university, and I didn't even have a university degree, because when I was at university, I just said, I'm fed up with this, and I left. So I did a degree much later, so Frank Knowles, who was one of the founders of Eurolect, and Peter Rowe at Aston University, are the people who got me to join Eurolect. Marilyn Corriard and Thierry, who actually I met both in Hungary, and they were the people who got me to come along to meetings and actually organize a meeting. Thierry is an enormous friend of lexicography and of me. And he's one of the prime movers, so a maker. And then some absent friends, we mustn't forget, John Sinclair, of course, Paul Bogart, who I miss desperately, Adam, Tony, and then all the people who I've been working with, basically, and I'm not going to read all the names here, but I might well add Anna, Rash, Rosamund, Uli, Carla, Michael, the list, all the Eurolex members and boards, because it is such a fantastic, friendly group of people, but that also means it's a dynamic group of people. And every time you meet more people, so you're in a network. This is part of praising. It's part of making that network spread the message. So, this is a tale in two parts. First part, then, is about lexicography as an area of research, which is going to be the academic side, which will be both a homage to Georgian lexicography and something about research evaluation, which is an unnecessary evil. You got it. You will not get away from it. But you can make research evaluation work for you if you do it intelligently. And funding, which if you're lucky, you might have. Then, because I actually do some research myself, I want to talk about several harmless drudges. Antoine Fertière, who wrote a great French dictionary in the 17th century, and an unsung hero, Henri Basnage de Beauval, who revised the dictionary of Fertière and made an absolutely monumental work, which I'm working on now, and I'll give you a little bit of an insight into just how fantastic he was, is. So, the praise comes as a subject from the appeal of Georgian lexicographers in 2010. I was president and I was asked to help the Georgian lexicographers get recognition. For many of us, we may be in a country where research gets full recognition and we are part of the furniture. It's not the case everywhere. And this was an appeal for recognition, because they were not being getting due recognition in evaluation exercises. If you don't get an evaluation exercise, you don't get the funding, etc., etc. So as to try and get dictionary building recognised and become a priority for our state. So we replied, as me as president, but I am only first amongst equals. Any president who relates is first amongst equals and the rest of the board. So it's not just purely me writing. So what I wanted to put together was to prove something which is very important to me, is the absolute centrality to our identity of culture and the fact that culture is carried by language. And that I use the word nationality, but it's language communities, it's feeling you belong, is what you is a reference to you. And that this was a very important thing to underline, and the fact that if you want to maintain that linguistic identity, there is no better tool than a dictionary, because we can record, we can show the variations, and we can help people value it, and we can help people from outside the country access it. So this was our response to this appeal. So, language and culture, you can't separate them. Language is culture and culture is language. You have, don't forget, the beginnings of corpus linguistics, before corpus linguistics was invented, really arose from the meeting between Bronislaw Malinowski and John Rupert Firth in London. This is where contextualist theory, which underlined corpus linguistics, came about. So, you look at anthropology, you look at ethnology, neither of them really works if you don't have somebody recording the words. That's us. We can look at disappeared and disappearing languages. I have a student who's working at the moment on Wendat. Wendat were a Canadian Indian tribe which has disappeared, their language had disappeared. And he was just doing a historical analysis, but I said, where's the dictionary? So he found a dictionary which had been written by a Jesuit priest, Sagar, and this gives us access to their culture and the words that they were using. In 2010, we had a marvelous plenary from Sarah Ogilvy on Aboriginal languages. So this is us giving our contribution to culture so that even the disappeared can carry on living. We then, of course, have all the lesser spoken languages. We have a European chart, and we are central to that. Signing is not ratifying or applying. Some small countries of Europe, like France, have signed, but they've not ratified. So we still have problems with letters spoken languages like Breton. UBS is actually in Brittany, and that is our language, which is a fastly disappearing language, because it's not being supported. So I want to avoid the question of status. So my quick buzz from the Bible, which is one of the verses I'd like to cite most, tolerance. You might have your theory, but there are many different ways of looking at lexicography. There are many different ways of looking at lexicography research. If you have infighting, you're lost. So there are many, this is the King James version, which I think is the only version, but there are many rooms, houses, whatever you want, there's many ways of thinking. We have the art of lexicography, because let's face it, the origins are craftspeople working hard. The harm is drudges. But craftspeople have skill. A Boule cabinet, I wouldn't have one in my house, I think they look ugly. I couldn't afford to pay the insurance anyway. But they're worth a fortune, and the craftsmanship is enormous. So, what's the difference between a work of art and a dictionary? None. You can look at it as a tool, but you can see it as a work of art. Value it, praise it. We do have a problem of identity, because of course we've got the art and craft, and we've got the academia. We've got explorers, not all of them you will know, like Lagadoc. He just happened to be born in the same town as my wife. He wrote the first dictionary in France. And what I like to say when I'm pointing out things to my French colleague, the first dictionary in France was a dictionary in Breton. It was Latin, Breton, and French. Lagadoc came from Orléans. Calipino, of course, Robert Estienne with his amazing dictionaries. These are the explorers, the people whose heritage we still use, even in the format of our dictionaries now. These are the people who did it. We have the great scholars like Littré, Grimm, Murray. We have the professionals, and I thought I'd give a plug for Sue Atkins, because there are so many great professionals, but Sue is somebody who's a dear friend and a good friend of Urelet's, who's not here today, so I thought I'd give Sue a couple of these just examples. Academia then has recently taken an interest in lexicography. We explore the past, we explore the present. We analyze dictionaries and the language that goes with it. We build new models, both theoretical and practical. So this is what our role is. We might not necessarily all be making, but we are an essential part of the big wheel. Scholarly lexicography can be carried out in many ways. You may have nationally funded prestige academies, which can be extremely essential to valuing the language, as the Académie de la Corsica, the Académie Française, the Royal Academy in Spain, and the Frisk Academy. These are places of research, but then we also have places of teaching and research, universities, and this is where you have a problem, possibly of the status of how we're recognized and the funding that goes with it. So, to sort things out, an ode to lexicography. That's a little sideline because ode is, of course, the Oxford Dictionary of English, which is also one of my favorite dictionaries, so this is where I got my definitions from. Drudgery, then, hard, menial, or dull work. Dull, lacking interest or excitement. Menial, not requiring much skill or lacking prestige. We're off to a bad start. However, you can also look at it another way. Botany is hard. Now, why do I use botany? Well, I'll tell you something. When I was a teacher of English, I was embedded in a research group of molecular biology. Lots of very big, very expensive machinery. Extremely white rooms where amazing things were being done. But in the corridor, there was one man who had the nicest room of the lot because his room was full of books and totally disorganized, like my desk is disorganized. But that was the botanist, the one botanist. He got no research funding because botany is not interesting. But he got lots of funding from my friends in the molecular biology department because, as they said to me, if he's not there, we don't work. If nobody discovers plants and looks at the plants, this is what I want to say about lexicography. The work of a lexicographer, as Nicolas Marechal said once, is slow. It requires great patience and slowness. So this harmless drudgery is something which is slow, and like botany, we're picking on words, we're looking at the words, but we are essential. You may have the most wonderful electronic dictionary, but if you don't have anything to put in it, and if you don't realize that it is not just lexical functions that you're looking at, but language, which is something that is used by real people for real needs, then you're missing something. And I go back to a chapter written in a book for Patrick Hanks, a chapter written by Michael Rundle about elegance and descriptive elegance. Even if you're writing a very short entry, is an art. And let's face it, we do write very short entries. And to be able to encapsulate all in just a few words is an absolute art. We should praise that. It's not easy to do. It is also exciting as a field. I hope I'm speaking to the converted. It's cumulative, obviously. We discussed the word in one of the papers that I chaired the other day of plagiarism, which is because you find over time distinct reuse of previous dictionaries. But at the same time, that's essential. You're building up your word list by using the word list of other people and building on it. So you're building on past knowledge. It's constantly evolving because user needs are evolving. I often give a history of French lexicography to my students, and I say, well, why is that dictionary there? Because French society has changed. And therefore the needs have changed. And we are experts at following those. So we do follow user needs. We are essential to learning and literacy. If you read the front of Caldrey's 1604 dictionary, he found that even women could learn to read. And other people of lesser capacity, things have changed. This is why I played Sue Atkins. We've always been at the forefront of technological change. Printing, we were there at the beginning. Mass printing, that's how you could get lots of dictionaries out e-lexicography, therefore the technical approaches, we're there. We're everywhere. I often say to people, you know, your computer just won't work if there's no dictionaries there, because you can't Google without some dictionary of some form. IT, internet technology, is exciting, but we still forget the lexicographer and the botanist, and this is one of the challenges to the European Union, because they only like things that flash and technology, and they will forget the botanists. So, all for E, but don't forget content. So, recognition and funding. This is about finding our place. There's an academic pecking order, and certainly in France, I don't peck very well, because there's several things wrong with what I do. One is that lexicography is practical, and it is not noble, because noble is literary research, and there's a pecking order in that, where we do practical things. Often we're teaching vocational courses, and that's definitely not it. And then there's always the old guard. There's always people who are going to stop the funding flow for some reason, because we're young, surprisingly enough. There are older disciplines, so we have to find our place, and praising ourselves is important. We can gain kudos, but kudos, you can't eat it. Research needs funding, that's important. You don't just need a pencil to write a dictionary definition. So if you look at funding streams, this is the warning I'm giving people. I am heavily involved in policy work now. Accidental, but in many ways I'm glad, because I can show what is happening. In Horizons 2020, which is the big European research funding stream, we have Challenge 6, which we fought for, which is for social sciences and humanities. It's a bit of a random record, but there's lots of things in it. The success rate is very, 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 very. It's about 2.5%. Very narrow. Procedures are not always very clear. There are certain underlying priorities, but this is where we are. You also have a rule that was brought in Horizon 2020, which is called embedding. It means you get into a bed of a scientist who's got lots of cash. That was a theory, meaning that any scientific project has to have a piece of SSH research included, because you have societal implications. This, in fact, has never happened. It's never prepared. However, when I go to policy meetings, I hear people talking. I hear projects going pear-shaped. Things have gone wrong. And I say, you've got a language problem. And terminology is not going to solve your language problem. You need a dictionary. You need to know that people are not talking about the same thing. I worked on a European project with one of the keywords. In France, that has an entirely different meaning to in other countries, because in France, it starts in 1789 at the French Revolution, and it meant that the state is above all. So you use the word, they were using it in a questionnaire. They were translating the questionnaire, but people were not answering the same questions. They have a language problem. So we should be able to show that. We should be embedded with everybody. But we're not. But one of the problems at the moment, and I know about this, because people talk about Horizon 2020, which has just started, but the negotiations for the follow-up, which will be FP9, have already started. It started 2 years ago, and the option is to get us out. Simply because the new option is they want finished research, which is ready to go onto the market. Which is obviously dangerous. So we have to show we exist, not just us, but all the disciplines. Cost, by the way, is under threat. They wanted to nationalise it, meaning it wants to come under EC control, and already you are very, very lucky if you will get a normal research network. I have just started a network which I launched with a friend, but we are policy research. We're not doing disciplinary research. ENEL, who I think was one of the last to get through. So just be aware of this. We are Europe. It is us, even if I come from a country which has shot itself in the foot. So funding streams are also national. The problem is national depends on where you are, because there are rich countries in Europe. They don't think they're rich, they're moaning, they're complaining. Ask an English person if they think there's lots of money in English research. But when they just take a quick trip to Italy, and they'll find out what it means to get funding. So it depends on where you are. The other problem is a lot of countries are following the EC lead. They're losing what they call smart specialization, which means doing what you've always done. But they're excluding other people. You have Horizon 2020, I believe in France, we have France 2020. All that means is they're following exactly the same policy, and therefore the share for social science and language research is ridiculously small and may disappear. Language is always important. You'll always have people saying how necessary it is to have multiple languages in Europe, but lip service comes cheap. Are they willing to put the money in? So, what next? Well, we continue to be poor harmless drudges. Or we could raise the profile and we could show how important we are. You can do it. One of the great things that was done within, well, powered by Eurelex, was the fact that IJL, our journal, is now a high-impact journal. That gives us enormous visibility. That shows the quality. Eurelex congresses are also known to be high-quality congresses. So, this is one way of showing who we are. But evaluation and societal impact are another way. If you come from one of the ex-communist countries, you've probably got a point system. And I know in Poland, I think they call it Puktoza, the points disease, because you have a ridiculous arcane system of giving points to things, which actually orient your research. But what is coming out most strongly now in research evaluation is societal impact. And who has more societal impact than we do? So we have to show it. We've got to look at what researchers do, when, and why. Show it. We can valorize, horrible word, but we can give it value. Multidisciplinary, we do it. We have to do it. If you're writing a special language dictionary, you have got to work with language specialists, and you have got to work with subject specialists. Internationalism, who's more international than us? No. Why is it a child from a suburb of Bristol, like I was, ends up in a wonderful country like Georgia with all this wonderful international network? So we can value that. And we have this social impact. Avoid the usefulness trap. But what I mean by that is, don't let people tell you that you only exist because you're a service industry for them. It's one way of showing ourselves, but if you do end up in the usefulness trap, you will only ever be considered as a secondary function. So we can value ourselves, we can turn the system around. Research evaluation can be peer-based, and you have to make sure that the old guard are taught what evaluation means, and that they value what we do. It's possible. A lot of research is evaluation-based funding. There you have to fit into the system, and systems can be very weird, but you can turn the system around. I think they might be surprised when I said it in languages engineering, but this is because I work with bibliometricians. And bibliometricians simply looked at our output and said, you're engineers. What does that mean? It means you go to lots of conferences, you publish lots of proceedings, because a lot of our work has immediate use. But the problem is, engineering is not sexy in academia, because it's practical, it's vocational, and according to them, well, as a practical vocational, you can earn your own funds. You don't need research funding. It's not true. But this is why proceedings in many evaluation systems are not recognized. We have to change that. We can change it by showing that we are vital. Research missions then, this wasn't about lexicography. This comes from a very important Dutch research center in evaluation of what research is about. Research produces knowledge for its own sake. So do we. We can look at a dictionary because it is fascinating and interesting, and there is nothing wrong with that. We help define and solve economic and social problems. We certainly do. Create a knowledge base for further technological and social innovation. We do that. We give to give actual cultural and social developments. To give meaning, sorry. We do that. We tick all the boxes, so why don't we show it? We can. Evaluation requires societal impact. We have that impact. I won't really let you read it, but I'll show you quickly. This is the League of European Research Universities, which just last month I was reading from the plane. I read lots and lots of policy statements. Published a research note on discovery research, trying to inform the negotiators of the European Commission that you must not forget that the best research, the best products, were never planned. You have to let people have blue sky research. And if you have blue sky lexicography, you will have wonderful things coming out of it. If you simply give them work on current dictionaries, current, if you simply transform your dictionary from paper to E, you ain't got nothing new. So you have to have the blue skies, because the blue skies will produce the dictionary of tomorrow, or it will produce nothing, but it doesn't really matter, we've done wonderful research. This is important. Fighting back is important. Defending research. The European Science Foundation was wonderful, it's gone. It is now a club of scientists. Science Europe no longer has any disciplinary panels, so, and in fact the person of social science and humanities, who I know well, has just left. So we're losing our voice. These people, Science Europe, have policy voice. They're governed by rich countries who are telling Europe what they must do, and Europe is listening. So if we don't put our voice in, other people are speaking for us. So you can collaborate. Everlearning is an association of research evaluation professionals. It's currently presided by its founder, who is an increasingly fat English person who lives in France and wears bow ties. I give weight to my research. But we're research professionals, so you wouldn't want to join us. But we can show you what we do and how we can possibly help. NRESH is a cost action we have just got, because we're looking at research across Europe, and we are going to embarrass countries that use point systems. Because if they want to develop how the rest of Europe is changing, then we can influence the way they work. Peer is a cost action on peer review, which is happening. Just look on the website, you will find them. And they're trying to show how peer research, peer evaluation sort of works, and how we can improve it. And the last one, which our association, Evelyn, just recently joined, but any association, European association can join, which does include Eurodex, is the Alliance of European Research Associations. The job of EASH is to actually influence policy. They attend high-level meetings, or listen to a high-level meeting, to try and defend it. That's what I'm saying. You've got to react. You've got to participate. So praise is about accepting variety, the many mansions from the Bible. It's about promoting our field and not just knowing we're wonderful, make sure everybody sees it. And this is why there's always a political element. There was a political element when I organized Eurolex in Lorient, because I was able to show the importance of Breton. There's a political element here, obviously, because it's showing all of Georgia, but also the rest of Europe, why we're so important, why language is so important, and why it's so important to collaborate. So we promote the field. We can turn research evaluation from a punishment so that we call the tune. We can. I'm sounding like Obama. I must change that. Yes, we can. Right. We should praise the field and join forces with others. We should valorize through active lobbying. You have to be active, and EASH allows you to lobby and not just accept divided rule that you all lose. See, you don't valorize, you don't show societal relevance. You might get kudos, but you won't get cash. I want the cash. We all need it. So, for the people who didn't get up early, I can now start the second part. But you're wonderful, you all got up early, I got up early too. Right. The second part is I want to illustrate something that I do, and it is related to what I've said before, because it's still praise for lexicographers and a little bit of harmless drudgery. Because it's something I discovered. My work has mostly been, as I told you, I was working in a molecular biology research group, so obviously I'm interested in the language of molecular biology. I can talk to you for hours about Striga asiatica, which, as you all know, is a parasitic plant, which connects onto other plants like tomatoes, maize, etc., using holothurium. It's wonderful, it's exciting. They asked me to write a terminology, and I tried to define the word holothurium, and I got shot at from all angles. So I said, I'm not doing terminology. Let's have lexicography and look at the variety of meanings of the word. So this was my normal work, working on science, but then accidentally, I found myself going back in time into the French 17th century, and I found that this could help me in my current science work. So what I'm finding is an insight into late 17th century lexicography, which is fairly extraordinary. It's a window, because of the cultural element, onto late 17th century, early 18th century world of science. You'll see why in a bit. Incredibly innovative lexicography, which I'll try and show you rapidly. very useful content of scientific and cultural relevance. Actually, I can't remember which talk, somebody was speaking about weird cures that they found in the dictionary. Actually, pharmaceutical companies are interested in those weird cures because there might be value in them. So dictionaries actually contain environmental information of first order importance. If you're looking at landscape, there is environmental information there. There is information on medical systems, there's information on legal systems. It is highly relevant now, and it's hidden. And I also think it's a contribution to what I call humanities-driven digital humanities. That is, don't let geeks control the system. We need tools, but we also need the botanists to be able to do their humanities research with those tools. So this is what this is about. We call the 17th century in France a century of dictionaries because it begins with the dictionary of Nico. If you're a smoker, nicotine, but he also did useful things. And Dusser, who in fact based his dictionary at the beginning of the century on the word Nico. It ends with Antoine Fertière and Henri Bazage de Beauval. So during this period of 100 years, there's enormous changes in lexicography and in French lexicography, vast amounts. What were the motivations? Well, it was changing society. You had a rising bourgeoisie, and they needed access to language. I often say with Estienne, he was teaching the bourgeois gentilhomme so that they could say things in Latin and look impressive without understanding what they were saying. But here we've got the rising bourgeoisie and they wanted information. Learning they needed. Prestige of the language was vital, hence the Dictionnaire de l'Académie Française. It was the prestige and the commercial interest, which is often forgotten. People were buying dictionaries. Printing was not so fast, but there was an enormous market. So, it had value. There were constraints. The constraints were financial, surprisingly enough. There were controls on publication. There was censorship. You might not be allowed to publish a dictionary. And there was an old guard trying to stop things changing. The old guard in France was, of course, the Académie Française. It had the funding, it had the power, and it was in no hurry. In fact, in the beginning of the Académie Française, there were two groups of people. There was the nobility, who bought in because they were nobility, and there were the very educated bourgeoisie, who were there because they had a brain, and they were actually getting cash to do their work. Because they were getting cash to do their work, they were in no hurry to finish a dictionary. So this rather frustrated Antoine Fertière, because, I'll give you more details about him after, because he wanted a better dictionary, a bigger dictionary, he wanted it fast. He published an outline of his project for a dictionary, and the result was he was kicked out of the academy, and after 4 years of exchanges of pamphlets, he died. But his dictionary was published. It was published in the Netherlands by a very dynamic Dutch publishing company. 4 years later, the Académie Française finally brought out their dictionary, simply because when Fertière's dictionary came out, it was presented to his chief supporter, who was actually the King of France, who made very sarcastic comments to the Academy of, look what I've got. So they brought out their own. 2 years later, Lear's publishes a second edition. Why? Commercial interest. Don't let the Academy corner the market, we've got to get ours out. So it has value. The protagonist then, Antoine Fertière was a bourgeois. He trained as a lawyer and he entered the church because it looked like a good thing to do. He owned a couple of parishes, he sold them off and he bought an abbot position because it gives him a good title. He never actually went there because you don't go to your abbey. He lived in Paris, because Paris is the center of the galaxy. He was buried there, but only after he died. He was a member of the Academy. He was a man of letters. And he very quickly got caught, like so many people do, in lexicography. But he wanted a general language dictionary that would cover not only polite language, but the arts, crafts, and science. He wanted a complete dictionary. A dictionnaire universel. The reason he wanted to do it was to show that you could say anything in French. He didn't want to prescribe. He didn't want to exclude foreign words, but to show that French was a mature language, which is why you have words like, if you were reading it phonetically in French, aisle, because it's written that way, but in fact it's ale, a drink drunk by English nobility. Beer. He puts the word in, because it was a word which was being used at the time. He fought a battle over the privilege, which was the censorship right to publish, and he lost, which is why this abbot of the Catholic Church, at a time of zero tolerance, got in contact with a Protestant philosopher in the Netherlands and arranged for his dictionary to be published abroad 2 years after his death. Next protagonist is Bastien de Beauvoir, Henri. He was a French Huguenot lawyer. He wrote a major book on the tolerance of religions in 1685. In 1686, the Edict of Nantes, which gave the possibility of Protestants to practice their religion, was annulled, and he had to flee. So his tolerance, he lost. He went to the Low Countries, where his brother was already working, and he needed to live. How could he live? Well, he lived by writing. And he wrote a journal, became what we call a journalist. And this Histoire des ouvrages des savants, but then he was persuaded. There are his letters, some of his letters can still be read, where he was persuaded by Lears to take on this work of a dictionary. He said, I'll do a few pages to see if I can manage it, see if I like it. The result was a 5,000 page dictionary, built on the basis of Fertier's work. He never claimed it as his own. The 1701 dictionary is the Fertier. It is always called the Fertier. It is Fertier's picture on the front page. It is simply marked revised and enlarged by Henri Bastien de Beauvoir, who, about whom we know actually rather little. A man of great merit, but one of the hidden people. It's like thinking that the Oxford English Dictionary is only Murray and forgetting the editors that follow on. It's this thing, but at least they get more praise than poor Henri does. So, Lears were a Protestant, well, publishing house, they were Protestant. They were based in La Haye and Rotterdam. Lears was an incredibly talented businessman, talented publisher, great friend of the philosopher Pierre Bell, a protector of the Protestant elite there because he gave them work, but a very astute businessman. This was a market. This was saying you could get your dictionary on the market first, and you weren't allowed to sell them in France, but that didn't stop them crossing the border. Then a dictionary. So this is the Universal Dictionary, the Dictionnaire Universel. It's an encyclopedia before encyclopedia were invented. Some of the dictionary definitions are incredibly detailed, and the one on architecture gives the history of architecture, but it also gives you all his opinions on the architecture of the time and how debased Romanesque architecture was, because they were just discovered the Renaissance architecture, which tells you why the churches were being destroyed to build a modern one. So you get this encyclopedic information. After his death, the dictionary was taken up by the Jesuits of Treville, who wanted to, they plagiarized it, use their own dictionary, because they said that the dictionary of Bastien was a Protestant dictionary, because in fact he never made comments, Fertier did, about religion. He simply made it more neutral. But Jesuits didn't like the neutrality, destroyed the Protestant economy. It was literally that. We get our dictionary on the market, they will lose their cash. So you can see the importance of dictionaries and the fight, which is quietly going on. What makes it fascinating? Well, in fact, it's incredibly systematic. These people were working by candlelight using quills. Think about it. Systematic, concise, not always concise, but very often very well detailed with great concision. Illustrative, they give you lots of information. Pedagogical, I will show you because I'm just discovering this. Right, encyclopedic, scholarly, culturally significant. I'll move quickly now because I'm getting excited. They have value, they were a cultural asset. They do exist. You can find them now on the French National Library's PDF. They're resources by historians and history specialists, but we're not exploiting them for their content. Lexicographers are not looking at them quickly, correctly. I'll go past this one. I just started showing what I'm doing. This is the entry for carpentry, or at least my organization for carpentry. All I'm doing is working systematically through all the entries which he says are a term of carpentry, and you can build an ontology. He is telling you how it was done. The fact that you have an abu, which is a joint, and you do it in these different ways. You can find that information. We can make it available. I work a lot on naval terminology, because carpentry is naval. You can't build a ship without it. And the best carpenters were naval carpenters. The verbs are incredibly complex. He starts off getting definitions, but if you look at but every synonym has an example with it to show you how you use it and how they are different. So that ébattre une maison is to demolish your house. You have the link. The naval maneuvers are described in collocations. You're shown how to attack another ship, how to bend the keel of a boat. All of this information is there through the collocations. It's incredibly wide. I put in this one on laughing, which you can see very well, but hasn't one on laughing. The important thing on laughing is he declines the verb. But then he gives examples of usage. Declining the verb, giving examples of usage, we're in the 17th century. It's a full pedagogical dictionary, because unlike Fertier, he was an emigre, he was abroad. He saw the problem. We don't have it written, but this is what he was doing in the dictionary. He declines, he gives examples, he gives incredible phraseological input. So you can find out all the expressions of phraseology. Some of them exist today, some of them don't. He gives his resources. And I believe that through his sources, I can find his corpus, because this was the journal he was publishing. He was publishing a journal which was a book of, it was a description of everything that was being published in Europe. He had short reviews of all the books. He received the books, they were reviews, he publishes them. That's why all his scientific information was the science of the time. So I believe that if we can work through that, we can possibly get to the sources. I finish. I praise lexicography because it's an ancient craft and a modern discipline. It's an ancient craft, but it's a very innovative work. We have wordsmiths and their skills. Historical lexicography, which we don't quite even know, opens windows on the past, but it brings potentially vital knowledge. It interests people. People like history. You valorize the cultural and language wealth of a country. You can make that data accessible to people, and you can give new models to help people get that information better. So, let us praise lexicography, lexicographers, and thank you.